Out in Los Animas County, Colorado, at the entrance to a canyon in the foothills of the Sangre de Cristo Mountains, sits the ghost town of Ludlow. The key site in what came to be known as the Colorado Coalfield War and the Ludlow Massacre.
Just crazy. It's over 100 years ago now. Yeah, this one went down in history, all right.
The Guild of the Gilded Age came out of the earth. But someone had to go in there and get it. And that someone sure wasn't going to be anyone from the elite robber baron Rockefeller family, who owned and operated Colorado Fuel and Iron, the largest coal company in the West at the time, controlling some 72,000 acres of coal land at its height. Working conditions in these mines, including those owned by one of the wealthiest families in American history at the time, were awful. Miners worked in extremely dangerous and deadly conditions for 12-hour days, 7 days a week, to make a measly 80 cents per ton of coal. The miners took home an average of $1.68 a day, which, adjusted for inflation, is just under $30 a day in 2022. They weren't paid for time they spent prepping mine areas to minimize hazards to workers, such as cave-ins, as this was referred to as dead work. The miners were required to live in company shacks and otherwise isolated company towns with curfews overseen by company guards, with no choice but to educate their children in company-dominated schools and forced to use company scrip to shop in company-owned stores, where prices were quite high. This model of secluded living, where every single aspect of worker life was dominated by the corporation, was not random. It was by design, run out of something called the CF&I Sociological Department, because the company had that, which was headed up by Dr. Richard Warren Corwin. Dr. Corwin was a surgeon with the Colorado National Guard, a member of the Colorado State Board of Health, and a 33rd degree Freemason who belonged to the ancient Arabic Order of the Mystic Shrine, the ancient and accepted Scottish Rite, and the Knights Templar of Colorado. He was also chief surgeon for CF&I for 49 years and an outspoken eugenicist. Eugenics being the pseudoscientific philosophy of the betterment of humanity through hereditary manipulations, including forced institutionalization, forced sterilization, and forced abortions. Dr. Corwin also happened to run the CF&I Sociological Department for a number of years as the Rockefellers took control of the company in the early 1900s, well before the Ludlow Massacre. In fact, Rockefeller Jr. was one of America's leading eugenics proponents, if not the biggest proponent in American history, and had spent at least $100 million on eugenics-related programs. Some of that money funding eugenics-related programs coming out of CF&I's Sociology Department, and therefore being implemented on the workers and their families. And when I say Dr. Corwin was a eugenicist, this is a man who proudly advocated for government-backed eugenics programs, including the teaching of eugenics education in schools, which he referred to as the only hope of improving our race or saving our nation. And he referred to children in categories such as the feeble-minded or mentally defective, which he separated out from the quote, morons, the higher class of defectives. Dr. Corwin would go on in the last years before his death to accept a nomination into the Colorado Eugenics Committee, which was created to push pro-eugenics propaganda and legislation in the state. And the man has literally been described as, quote, perhaps the most prominent practitioner of this ideology in Colorado during its heyday, by history teacher Brian Clayson and history professor at Colorado State University Jonathan Rees. This CF&I industrial welfare plan, as it's referred to, was based on an early understanding of applied sociology, which just sounds like a nice way of saying social engineering, in part to combat worker strikes. The department implemented the settlement house model, as it was called, which was intended in part to, quote, foster labor stability by transforming the lifestyles and habits of the immigrant workers and their families, end quote, and to inspire loyalty to the company, according to professor of sociology at UT Arlington, Frank Weed. In his University of Colorado PhD thesis regarding the irony of the sociological department's educational reforms in CF&I coal camps, Bradley Bartels noted that these social engineering endeavors were heavily guided by efforts to assimilate their largely immigrant workforce, including the school-aged children, and train them to become more docile menial laborers, living under an even greater degree of socioeconomic and political corporate control over their lives. However, it would seem the company's programs included progressive educational reforms for both children and the parents who attended night classes, which seemingly backfired, actually increasing autonomy and class solidarity, resulting in social and economic empowerment for both the adults and children living in these camps. In other words, it sounds like people of all ages in these camps became educated enough to realize how badly they were getting hosed by CF&I, and empowered enough to do something about it. But I digress. To say company corruption was an issue is an understatement. Explosions at these mines causing mass casualties were sadly common. For example, an explosion in the CF&I mine near Primero, also in Los Angeles County, killed 24 miners in 1907. And another 75 miners were killed in another explosion at the exact same mine in 1910. Following the second explosion, the Colorado Bureau of Labor Statistics actually used the phrase cold-blooded barbarism in describing CF&I's neglect of safety measures in its mine. These working conditions were not only incredibly dangerous, but the living conditions in these company towns were also quite pitiful. After a mine exploded in Starkville, Colorado, killing 56 miners, an inspector sent in by local authorities made a report describing the conditions these miners and their families lived in as smacking of the direst poverty. Most of the company homes, which sat in the shadow of the coal washers and were bathed in smoke from the coal ovens and covered in coal dust, did not have running water or sewerage. The inspector wrote, "The people reflect their surroundings. Slatternly dressed women and unkempt children throng the dirty streets and alleys of the camp. One is forced to the conclusion that these people must be very poorly paid, else they would not be content to live in this fashion." Due to the harsh working conditions for meager pay and abysmal living conditions, thousands of CF&I miners went on strike in September 1913 after attempting to organize into the United Mine Workers of America. But CF&I refused to meet with union organizers. In response, the miners were promptly thrown out of company housing, so they erected tent cities at various sites in what was known as the Southern Coal Fields in Colorado near the mines to be able to continue to strike and block scab replacements in the meantime. Of these tent cities, the one near Ludlow was the largest. The miners had what seemed like some pretty basic demands by today's standards. They wanted an 8-hour workday. They wanted compensation for digging coal at a rate of a ton being 2,000 pounds, instead of the company's use of the long ton at 2,200 pounds. And they wanted the weight checkmen to be elected by the miners, the idea being the company's weightmen were not exactly the most honest with their calculations. They wanted to be paid for the so-called dead work required to prep mines to minimize hazards to their lives on the job. They wanted the right to choose where they lived, what doctors they saw, and the right to shop at any store, not just the company's overpriced one. They also asked for semi-monthly payment of wages in lawful money, not scrip, and they wanted the union to be recognized as their bargaining agent. Strikers also wanted actual enforcement of Colorado's laws. Imagine working a job where you really just want the laws already on state books to be enforced as written and passed. As Colorado had one of the highest mining death rates in the whole country at the time, double the national average. But that's what happens when a political system is dominated by the elite owners of major corporations, as opposed to being the servants of the people who elected them. In response to the strike, the Colorado Fuel and Iron Company used a portion of its special budget that it held for dealing with union issues to hire the notorious Pinkerton-esque Baldwin Felts Agency to protect the mines and harass the striking miners. These agents formed goon squads that would drive around in armored cars with machine guns on raids, firing into the tent cities, as they reportedly did on October 17, 1913, when they shot one little girl in the face, another little boy in the legs, and killed a miner.
So elite industrialists were able to hire detective agencies to use something called the Death Special, which was a reinforced car with a Gatling gun mounted on the back, which they would periodically drive along the road and just spray fire into the tent company. How is that legal? How is that allowed at all?
Yeah, it isn't.
And they were paid pennies an hour.
Pinkerton is still around, too. They're, I think, the oldest private detective agency, private police force in this country.
This reason is cited for why strikers felt it necessary to arm themselves. They also felt it necessary to dig pits underneath their tents to protect themselves and their families from drive-by shootings. And they reportedly slept in these holes in the ground so they wouldn't get murdered in the night while they slept. As tensions rose and the situation quickly started getting out of control, by the end of October 2013, Colorado Governor Elias Ammons called out the National Guard at the behest of Rockefeller. The militiamen weren't getting paid, however, as the state auditors sympathized with the strikers and withheld funds. So many walked and were replaced with civilians. It has been reported that Governor Ammons took the Rockefeller family up on an offer to put their own hired men in National Guard uniforms. The strike dragged on throughout the winter. A strikebreaker's body was found out near some railroad tracks along the tent colony in Forbes on March 10, 1914. The New Yorker's Caleb Crane noted, "He was either a victim of bludgeoning or a drunk who fell on the railroad tracks, depending on who you asked." The company quickly accused the striking miners of murder, and General John Chase, then commander of the Colorado National Guard, responded by ordering the Forbes colony to be destroyed and all other tent colonies to be subsequently disbanded. Meanwhile, Congress summoned John D. Rockefeller Jr. up to D.C., who testified it was his belief the miners were actually striking against their own will under the coercion of the union, and that he and his company were fighting for the miners' freedom, and that union organizers needed to be kept from being able to, quote, interfere with employees who were thoroughly satisfied with their labor conditions. When a congressman asked Rockefeller, "And you would do that if that costs all your property and kills all your employees?" Rockefeller Jr. replied, "It is a great principle." All of this culminated in the events of April 20th, 1914 in Ludlow, the day after Orthodox Easter, and just a few days after Rockefeller's testimony. The National Guard placed an M1895 Colt Browning machine gun on a tripod on Water Tank Hill, above and aimed down at the striking workers' camp at Ludlow. And then they proceeded to take pictures of these guard members aiming this giant gun at striking workers who would later be gunned down and their families, including women and children. I'm not really sure why they thought these photographs were a good idea, but I digress. No one is clear who shot first. Pro-state, pro-corporate sources say it's a mystery. Pro-union sources say the troops began firing into the camps, targeting anyone who moved. In his New Yorker piece, Crane reports that shortly before the gunfire began, three explosions could be heard. Supposedly ordered, detonated by Colorado National Guard Lieutenant Carl E. Linderfelt as a signal. Lieutenant Linderfelt, a veteran of the Philippine-American War, had only served as deputy sheriff for a few weeks before the militia was activated. He'd been involved in a striker's battle in Berwind Canyon. Linderfelt later claimed he was under the impression martial law had already been declared, so he began running his portion of the Colorado National Guard in Ludlow, Hastings, and Berwind before the Guard was even officially called into the situation. and his men began to carry out illegal searches of private homes throughout the area for ammunition. Later in congressional testimony, a University of Colorado law professor called Brewster described Linderfelt as a brutal man who, quote, took pleasure in the spray of the machine gun over the colony. Prior to the massacre, that same Professor Brewster complained directly to the governor and asked for Linderfelt's removal after he witnessed Linderfelt beat a boy for attempting to take a train from Ludlow to Trinidad. Had Linderfelt been removed then, Professor Brewster claimed, the tragedy at Ludlow might have never occurred. Others would back up the professor's claims, including National Guardsman Captain Van Cease, who testified he purposefully stationed Linderfelt's company away from Ludlow at first due to related concerns with him. Linderfelt was said to have been overheard shouting things like, "I am Jesus Christ, and all these men on horses are Jesus Christ, and we have got to be obeyed." Under Linderfelt's rule, some striking miners were taken prisoner and held incommunicado, deprived of sleep, and tortured. Other strikers were reportedly forced to dig their own graves and invited to write goodbye letters to their families. A local district attorney was also reportedly threatened with jail if he interfered. Either way, after the three explosions sounded on the morning of April 20th, gunfire broke out between the militiamen and the miners at Ludlow. A 14-hour standoff ensued. The militiamen shot five strikers, an 18-year-old bystander, an 11-year-old boy, plus several dogs and chickens. Some women and children fled for the hills, while others hid down in the pits that had been dug beneath the tents. That evening, under cover of darkness, fire was set to the Ludlow camp. To this day, reporting differs, but over 20 people were killed in the unofficial Civil War, as the newspapers would later call it, including 11 children and two women who were asphyxiated by smoke when they attempted to hide in a pit that had been dug beneath tent number 58, that, like the rest of Ludlow camp, had been set ablaze. This pit came to be known as the Black Hole.
It's just hard to believe that they would shoot women and children over a union strike.
The morning after the initial carnage, the militiamen again set fire to the remaining tents. Were seen pillaging an accordion, sewing machine, suitcase, umbrella, and bicycle from among the striking miners' belongings. And then took even more pictures of themselves standing among the charred rubble where hundreds of tents once stood. This picture, provided by the Denver Public Library on the Colorado Coalfield War Archaeological Project website, describes the scene as, "In this photograph, troopers pose in defensive positions in the Ludlow ruins. This pose is most likely for the photographer, and not for any real threat." According to newspaper reports out a few weeks later, after hours of eyewitness testimony, the coroner's jury returned with a verdict that the state militiamen or mine guards or both purposefully set fire to the Ludlow tent colony and burned to death two women and 11 children after 10 men had fallen in battle between the militiamen and the strikers. One guardsman was also killed. Those who fired the tents with torches were found to be acting under direct orders of Lieutenant Linderfelt, or his colleague Major Patrick J. Hamrock. Witnesses to the tragedy testified that some of the soldiers actually walked among the women and children crawling on the ground screaming in terror while the men ruthlessly applied the torches to the tents.
In the politics of the day, they wanted to send a message that strikes were not going to be tolerated and that they would just disregard human life and shutting down these protests.
For its part, according to a report, the military blamed the death of their own Private Martin as exposing the Colorado militia youth to unheard of savagery, having an effect of exciting the soldiers into a frenzy, which, quote, may account for some things that took place later near the tent colony itself. End quote. Linderfelt was also charged and convicted of the assault of Maine Ludlow Camp Union organizer Louis Tekus after breaking the butt of his gun over Tekus's head. Tikus was then shot to death, hit 3 times, including once in the back, and a sergeant later testified to a military investigator under oath that Linderfelt had ordered Tikus' execution. Tikus' body lay exposed for 3 days afterward, though Linderfelt was never charged in connection with his death.
An embarrassment to the Rockefellers and ultimately a boon to their whole agenda. The blowback against the Rockefeller family after Ludlow was immense. The public was seething with anger about the emerging details, combined with an already tarnished public image. Just a couple years before, the Supreme Court ruled in May 1911 that Standard Oil, in violation of the Sherman Antitrust Act, had to be broken up. These 1911 antitrust hearings reminded the American public of the ruthless domination exercised by Standard Oil and the obscene wealth and power afforded its most infamous elite dynasty, now widely resented throughout the country. Meanwhile, the Rockefeller family had been crafting its plans to create a massive philanthropic foundation, following in the footsteps of the Carnegie Endowment and the Russell Sage Foundation. But even that was controversial, so controversial that the Rockefellers ultimately weighed against seeking a federal charter, which would invite greater public scrutiny, and instead obtained a charter at the state level in New York, where they could still direct their agenda. Testing the waters in the years leading up to their official creation in May 1913, the Rockefeller Foundation found that the public was, at the onset, suspicious of the undue powers associated with the spending of massive funds on public policy. This foundation was much more than a charity organization or even a tax shelter for the ultra-wealthy to shield against the inheritance tax, among other cards of the Monopoly community chess deck. It has been proven to be a vehicle for radically changing public policy in medicine, science, education, and more. Its outsized influence utilized the emerging field of sociology in tandem with eugenics policies then in vogue and heavily backed by the Rockefellers personally, which were developed and applied by the Rockefeller Foundation and other influential figures to engineer a new breed of Americans. These major factors were happening in the backdrop of what otherwise appeared to be a conflict between pro-union miners and a massive industry that dominated Colorado and its politics. After the hot war front of the Coalfield War died down, there were a series of hearings before the Commission on Industrial Relations, with John D. Rockefeller Jr. testifying in both January 1915 and April 1915 and making some startling revelations. For one thing, he denied the worst of it all. There was no Ludlow massacre, that he was ignorant of conditions in Colorado and that he knew nothing of the quote war. However, the correspondence obtained by Chairman Frank Walsh and read in detail during hearings proved otherwise. Rockefeller Jr. operated with notorious secrecy, but he was no innocent bystander. This headline from April 24, 1915 sums it up. Young Rockefeller had testified he knew nothing of conditions in coal fields, but letters indicated he was informed of every step and that his agents acted with his consent. Quote, "The committee today has made, as part of its record, a mass of correspondence not only showing the Rockefellers were in constant touch with every phase of the Colorado coal strike situation, but they knew the strike was coming and were prepared for it." Duh. I mean, did anyone really think that the Rockefellers were some kind of naive fools here? When cross-examined by Chairman Walsh, Rockefeller admitted that yes, he did have the power to reverse the decisions of the Colorado Fuel and Iron Company's elections for its directors, its presidents, etc., as a memo from the chairman of the executive board revealed. The article says that, quote, "the evidence showed the inside workings of dummy directorship and absentee landlordism, and that Rockefeller notified these officers he would back them to the limit." The timeline of evidence made clear that, quote, "no violence was committed until Troop A was formed, that the members of this troop did not wait until they were properly enrolled in the state militia, but shot up Ludlow a few days after they were organized, and, as many suspected, that these men were on the payroll of the company continuously." Walsh read from the letters and reports to show that Troop A, a volunteer organization, was formed of superintendents, clericals, and mine guards of the coal companies, Walsh then asked Rockefeller Jr., "Do you know that this troop fired into the tents of women and children at Ludlow and that they looted the dead and set fire to the tents of the people?" "I do not," Rockefeller Jr. replied in testimony. Another memo sent by Rockefeller Jr. to CF&I President Bowers indicated that the elder Rockefeller Sr. had been pleased by the news in the wake of the Ludlow massacre shootings. It stated, quote, "I know that Father has followed the events of the past few months in connection with the fuel company with unusual interest and satisfaction." Armed with this memo, Chairman Walsh sniped, "So your father was pleased when 5,000 men and their families went into the canyons to live rather than continue to work under existing conditions in the mining camp when armed gunmen were sent to attack them and when the Forbes tent colony had been riddled by machine guns?" Obviously, the tone of the writing in the memo was incendiary in the climate of public opinion. CF&I miners were forced to live in company housing under guard, compelled to buy from the company store, captive in sending their kids to company schools, and generally kept in isolation from the outside like some kind of cult. These are the types of exploitative conditions that are familiar to accounts of Jim Crow sharecropping, characters from the Grapes of Wrath during the Dust Bowl, or the quasi-feudal tenant-landlord system in upstate New York that triggered the anti-rent uprising in the 1840s. As the second largest employer in the state with some 60,000 employees, CF&I also had their own medical and sociological departments. Was that normal for private companies to have that stuff? Which were headed for five decades by one Dr. Richard Corwin, perhaps Colorado's leading eugenicist, who later developed screenings and policies put in place at the company intended to deal with so-called defectives he believed were flooding the workforce and schools. The company used these departments to shape the entire sphere of life for workers' families living under their thumb. For a company that subjected its workers to such base conditions, had some pretty advanced programs, however ill-conceived. But when profits dived in the years ahead of the strikes, these programs, which provided at least some benefits, proved to evaporate, a non-priority to a company characterized for its devotion to profits above all. The August 30th, 1915 Fresno Morning Republican reported, quote, "The direct cause of the strike, say the report, was the refusal of the mine owners led by the Rockefeller Company to grant a conference to representatives of the strikers. The Reverend Mr. Gaddis visited all the camps of the Colorado Fuel and Iron Company to ascertain the actual conditions. Testifying in May 1915, he summed up his judgment of the situation existing in these camps in the following language. Quote, "I have never seen a situation, to my mind, more despicable and damnable. It is an oligarchy that is controlling everything." And while tensions between unions, workers, and companies came to a head on one side of the equation, locally at the CF&I company, as well as nationally with the Rockefeller Foundation and a host of other organizations, including the Eugenics Records Office in Cold Spring Harbor, New York, formed in 1909, they pursued forced sterilization and other population control measures nationwide on poor and disenfranchised demographics in a way that was definitely punching down. Underfunding provided by Rockefeller, Harriman, and Carnegie, private institutions directed government action, with many states passing laws institutionalizing eugenics during the 1910s and 20s. Social control, locally at Colorado CF&I and more broadly across the country, had arrived in a big way. In fact, it was tested by the fuel company. In doing so, blame was shifted from unforgivingly harsh conditions in the social and work environment to individuals scapegoated for being supposedly genetically inferior, who were seen as contaminating the rest of the population. Certainly, Dr. Corwin expressed those views in his official capacity and other writings. And in the background, the trail of foundation funding amplified these views, even as foundations sought an evolution towards more sophisticated and, quote, scientific rationales for behavior modification during this formative phase of modern America. Yes, eugenics is unusually involved in a case that, once again, appears on the surface to have everything to do with labor disputes, pro- and anti-union politics, and worker strikes. But I digress. Getting back to the testimony of the Ludlow Massacre, even as his role in the whole affair publicly emerged and Rockefeller's enemies relished over the damning exposés, a rebranding effort was underway. John D. Rockefeller Jr. hired Ivy Lee, who would revolutionize the public relations field in his work to shift the image of his client. A pro-industry campaign was launched to, ultimately, win the loyalty of the public and the worker, and in many ways, to redefine society's dynamics. For Rockefeller, now under advisement by Ivy Lee, quote, "The public mind was confused with so much conflicting information, that is, about what really happened and who they really were and what it all meant to the scheme of things. And he would set the record straight through carefully crafted and prepared statements." Quote, "Ivy Lee is Rockefeller's press agent in Colorado. It will be remembered that just after the Battle of Ludlow, there was a storm of protest. Silent marchers dressed in mourning paraded in front of the Rockefeller headquarters in New York and at the home in Tarrytown. As fast as one set of marchers were arrested or jailed, another set took their places. Rocky didn't like this. To turn the tide of public opinion, young Rockefeller wrote to Ivy Lee suggesting a string of newspapers across the continent. To this, Lee replied, there's no doubt something can be done along these lines. Conditions had reached a point where the whole truth could no longer be suppressed. It was time to move to Plan B. But up until this point, the titan of industry had been basically his own worst enemy by neglecting the sentiments of the people. Quote, the witness, that is Rockefeller Jr., came to believe it was a mistake to maintain secrecy regarding corporations and determined to get the facts before the public, end quote. So he discussed this in his testimony after Ludlow. Thus, he was working to correct the public's misconceptions in a campaign that was ingenious in many ways to retake ownership of an issue that pro-union partisan politics and worker strikes had made much headway on and flip it. Yet, this was a just right balancing act. Chairman Walsh quoted a speech by Ivy Lee in which he had stated, quote, we must be very careful of the terms we allow to be lodged in the public mind, end quote. And that, folks, is what's really at stake, a skewing of public perception. Correcting the public perception, then, in an almost Grady from The Shining sense, included crafting a letter that was sent to influential people across the country, including President Wilson, and it was sent under the auspices that it was written by Colorado's Governor Ammon, even though it was written by Ivy Lee. The campaign targeted influential community leaders, including lawyers and clergy, for the purpose of molding public opinion against the strikers, with a then-revolutionary public relations campaign, a forerunner of direct mail marketing. They sent out bulletins with captivating slogans like, "The Struggle in Colorado for Industrial Freedom," and these were printed and addressed in Philadelphia, and then shipped to Denver, where they were mailed to create the opinion that the mine operators were behind the publication. Rather than Ivy Lee over there in Philadelphia. The effect then was to create a deluge of information about the Colorado situation from a variety of angles. Ultimately, the mailing list for the regular bulletins reached 19,000 names, including various individuals suggested in correspondence from Rockefeller, his staff, and other CF&I officials. Ivy Lee's work on behalf of the Rockefellers and the coal mine operators was a milestone in early public relations. Indeed, it was, quote, one of the most important episodes in the early development of public relations. And that's according to Kirk Holohan of Colorado State University in his public relations study of Ivy Lee and the Rockefellers' response. As the controversy brewed, Rockefeller and his staff recognized the need to stem the tide of negative public opinion that was directed towards CF&I and the Rockefeller family, end quote. This joint effort by Ivy Lee and Rockefeller would not only spin like a DJ for damage control, but it would also pivot to transform labor management relations, eventually creating something known as the Employee Representation Plan, aka the Rockefeller Plan, to counter union ethos in order to, quote, impart middle-class values to his workers. He believed that reconstructing their social and cultural values from language to sexual behavior would remove any socialist influences and create a better workforce. Lee's, quote, enlightened public relations philosophy would aim to pacify and reassure workers while winning loyalty from a neutral yet slightly supportive public. Lee wrote in one of the advertisements, quote, for many years past, our company has made systematic efforts to promote the welfare and happiness of its men. We recognize that the interests of stockholders and employees are really the same, and neither can prosper permanently unless the just rights of both are conserved. We are now developing an even more comprehensive plan, end quote. Lee also found that citizens were hostile to the Rockefeller name and didn't understand the family's limited role. Appeals were also made towards the psychology of Colorado's constituents as a whole. Quote, although most residents did not favor the Union, citizens were more outraged by the militarism that had taken place and the negative light shed on Colorado. Lee's research found that the Coloradans exhibited indifference towards the operators and antipathy towards the Union. Their concerns were mostly to, quote, protect the good name of the state. Otherwise, the state might face an economic decline because investors would be hesitant to risk money in the area. So that's the point that they appealed to the public on. And then adding to that, in addition to Ivy Lee, the Rockefellers also had a second point man for public relations to contain the fallout after the Ludlow Massacre, that being William Mackenzie King, a labor relations consultant and an iconic future Prime Minister of Canada, heading the Department of Industrial Research at the Rockefeller Foundation from the years 1911 to 1918. Mackenzie King closely coordinated relations during and after the 1913-1914 Colorado Coalfield War. Out of this crisis, William Mackenzie King crafted a whole new era in labor relations debate, going on to publish a book in 1918 called Industry and Humanity, a new study in the principles underlying industrial reconstruction. So they were building back on the ashes. And this dense book was a response not only to the Ludlow Massacre itself, but a sort of New Deal type of arrangement wherein they would try to get people to view capital and labor as natural allies rather than foes, who could then be mediated by governmental agencies who were given power to resolve disputes. And however ham-fisted, these efforts may have succeeded in allowing the Rockefellers to sweep the people off their feet and turn around their negative public image. By September 1915, the public relations campaign was in full swing, and John D. Rockefeller Jr. was seen dancing with the wives and daughters of the coal miners. Seriously, he got out on the dance floor after everything that had happened. Mr. Rockefeller, quote, danced with practically every woman and girl in the room, circulating reports and papers across the country that were designed to spread his good image. Ah, what a day to be a coal miner's daughter. While Rockefeller Jr. and various borrowed wives danced the, quote, hesitation waltz, a general public that had grown to detest these scions of wealth began to take the bait of public relations, and little by little shifted in their views, more in line with the image these powerful people wanted to imprint on the minds of its subjects, consumers, citizens, yeah. I think even the Rockefeller PBS documentary admits how opportunistic he was in exploiting the crisis and trying to make up to the public for it and try to introduce various goodwill gestures and get the public to start to go along and rebrand the Rockefellers as nice people. And he was so opportunistic about it that he really pleased Papa, you know, the original John D. Rockefeller. And of course set the stage for the five brothers and the things that they did. These are the people. They don't care about men, women, children. They don't care.
They were paying these people pennies an hour. Ludlow Massacre has been described as one of the most notorious incidents in the violent history of American employers crushing unions. It would be another 16 years before the coal mining industry would be officially unionized. Though it took so long, the events at Ludlow did eventually lead to state and federal legislation that would improve working conditions for American miners. In 1918, the United Mine Workers of America erected this monument to honor those who lost their lives in the massacre.
Today it sits out there, surrounded by a lot of nothing at the entrance to a canyon in the foothills of the Sangre de Cristo Mountains. Just past the empty ghost town of Ludlow.
What? Yeah, this one went down in history, all right. The unfortunate massacre that will live on in infamy and forever indict the Rockefellers.